Good day, everyone. We are going to talk today about the pharmacology of peptic ulcer disease presented by Ra'a Amr. So our outline for today is going to be the general introduction to the peptic ulcer disease. We will have the definition and some risk factors, and then we will dig deep into the drug classes and the treatment of peptic ulcer disease. So first of all, let's talk a little bit about the definition of the peptic ulcer. So what's a peptic ulcer? Peptic ulcer is a break in the superficial epithelial cells penetrating into the muscularis mucosa of the stomach or the duodenum. So as in the definition, so we have two main types of the peptic ulcer disease, mainly the duodenal ulcer, and then we have the gastric ulcer. We have a previous video comparison between the duodenal and gastric ulcer and digging deep into the peptic ulcer as a disease. Another type, we have the stress ulcers. It's a little bit debatable, but what exactly happens in here, that we have increase in the ACTH, that will increase the levels of cortisol, and then this will induce the ulcer. What are the common risk factors in peptic ulcer disease? We have stress, H. pylori, alcohol and smoking, and we can add in here the non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drugs. So it's part of the risk factors. Now, these are the most common causes of peptic ulcer. So we have the non-steroidal, the H. pylori infection, and then we have stress. As we said, it is debatable. Another classification we can have, that the H. pylori and the non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drugs are considered the chronic type of the peptic ulcer disease. We have the acute type, which comes after a severe trauma or stress that will induce an acute peptic ulcer. So now we will go into the pharmacology of peptic ulcer. What are the drug classes that are used? We have the antacids, the antimuscarinic drugs. We have the H2 blockers, proton pump inhibitor, prostaglandins, and we have the mucosa protective agents. And finally, we have the antimicrobial agents. From the beginning of the H2 blocker up to the mucosa protective agents, these are considered the hyposecretory drugs. Okay, so these are the hyposecretory drugs because they cause a remarkable decrease in the acid secretion that will help into the healing of the peptic ulcer. So let's begin with the first class of the peptic ulcer pharmacology. We have the antacids. The most important thing you should know in here is it is used only for prompt symptomatic relief. So what is used for prompt symptomatic relief in peptic ulcer or gastroesophageal reflux disease is mainly antacid, and this is really important for exam question. How does it do that? It does it by neutralizing the HCl and reducing the pepsin formation. We have two main types, the systemic and the non-systemic. We'll talk mainly about the non-systemic, which is the aluminum and magnesium hydroxide used mainly for peptic ulcer disease. What are the side effects? So for magnesium hydroxide, we have the diarrhea, and for aluminum hydroxide, we have the constipations. That's why we use them in combinations, so combinations, to counteract the effect of each other. Another thing, that all of the antacids can cause hypokalemia, so you have to be cautious with that. Also, drug-drug interaction in antacids is really high, and they decrease the absorption of many drugs, so you have to administer any other medication after 1 to 2 hours from the administration of the antacid. For example, the antihypertensive drugs, the iron, the fluoroquinolones, you have to be cautious with them and monitor the patient, give them 1 to 2 hours after the antacid administration. Then the second class, we will go for the antimuscarinic drugs, which is the pyrimidine. The exact mechanism of action, that it blocks mainly the M1 muscarinic receptors selectively, and the M1 muscarinic receptors will decrease the parasympathetic nervous system. So it will decrease the vagal stimulation, inhibiting the gastric secretion and decrease the pepsin secretion. So because it's opposing the parasympathetic nervous system in the gastric mucosa, it will cause the side effects will cause sympathetic manifestations like dry mouth, blurred vision, tachycardia, and photophobia. So now we will go for the third class, which is the H2 receptor blockers. I will talk a little bit about the receptors. We have the H1 receptor, the H3 receptor, and the H2 receptor. H1 and H3, this is not the scope of this lecture. They are not found in the gastric mucosa. The most important one, which is the H2, found in the gastric mucosa. And when histamine binds to it, it will activate the protein kinase cascade, which will lead to getting the proton out into the lumen to react with the Cl, forming the HCl, which is the gastric acid. So when you block this site, you won't have a formation of HCl. But the problem is with the H2 receptor blockers, they block it reversibly. So reversibly. This is the problem with the H2 receptor blocker. This is exactly what I have said, that H2 receptor blockers reversibly inhibiting the H2 receptor only without H1 or H3. What are the drugs in this class? We have the cimetidine, famotidine, and ranitidine. They all pass through the first pass metabolism in the liver, and most of them inhibit the cytochrome P450, mostly through the cimetidine. It is the most important one inhibiting the cytochrome 450. And they have many drug-drug interaction, and when the cimetidine inhibit this site, it will be the main concern for the oral anticoagulants and tricyclic antidepressants and ethanol, because their concentration will increase in the blood. Another thing you should know, that the famotidine is the most potent one of the three. So the uses for the H2 receptor blockers are mainly for the peptic ulcer disease, for the gastroesophageal, and they can be used for prevention of bleeding from the stress-related gastritis. I will talk a little bit about the cimetidine to explain the side effects, because it's really important to understand it. So let's talk about it a little bit. So cimetidine basically increases the prolactin. It increases the prolactin level. It inhibits the metabolism of estradiol, so it will increase the levels of estrogen into the blood. It will also inhibit the dihydrotestosterone from binding into the receptors, so it will have an anti-adrenergic effect. That's why when the patient takes cimetidine, sometimes they will have impotence because of the decrease in the dihydrotestosterone. They may have gynecomastia because of the estradiol levels, and galactorrhea because of the prolactin. So this is really important, and important side of question too. Okay? Another side effects from the H2 receptor blockers are the headache, myalgias, diarrhea, confusion, renal impairment, and it's not really used in pregnant women. For the fourth class, we are going to talk about are the PPI, proton pump inhibitors. So they basically work on the parietal cell, as you can see in here, inhibiting the HK-ATPase site in here, so it won't form the HCl. It won't form the HCl. The most important thing in here, that it inhibits this site irreversibly. So it inhibits it irreversibly. So irreversible inhibition. As we just said, the irreversible inhibition of the HK-ATPase in the parietal cells. And the most important thing in here also, that PPIs are considered the most effective therapy in anti-ulcer therapy. The dose is mainly once daily and does not need any adjustment for the renal or liver diseases. Some drugs are omeprazole, esomeprazole, pantoprazole, which is considered the IV form. You should also avoid the long-term use, because it increases the risk of infection, especially with Clostridium difficile causing Pseudomonas colitis, and increasing the rate of infection, especially pneumonia. They all metabolized in the cytochrome 450. That's why they have drug-drug interaction, so you have to be careful with them. The most potent one is the omeprazole, and the uses are usually the peptic ulcer and the gastroesophageal reflux. And the side effects, as you can see in here, they can be nausea, they can be diarrhea, headache, especially when it's taken in large doses, can cause encephalopathy, can cause GI disturbances sometimes, and cramps. And the most important thing, that PPIs can cause bone fracture, especially in the hip, wrist, and spine. So this is also an important question. Now let's go for the prostaglandin, which is the misoprostol, prostaglandin E1 synthetic analog. The most important thing that it protects against the non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drug peptic ulcer disease because of its cytoprotective action. For example, we have a 65-year-old patient taking paracetamol for her joint pain, which is failing. So she took ibuprofen instead. So you are concerned of the risk of peptic ulcer disease. So what can you do? So first of all, you make the non-steroidal as much as possible in low dose, okay? Or you can take the patient on COX-2 inhibitors if she doesn't have any cardiovascular risk factor. For example, you can put her in celecoxib if she doesn't have any cardiovascular risk factor. If not, if she has risk factor for cardiovascular disease, you can go with the normal non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drug, for example, ibuprofen, with a cytoprotective drug like misoprostol. Now let's go for the side effects. The side effects, you have diarrhea, abdominal pain, vomiting, and nausea and headache. The most important thing you should know in here that it is really contraindicated in pregnancy because it increases the uterine contraction that can cause abortion as a result. So two things important. It is protective action against the non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drugs, peptic ulcer disease, and contraindicated in pregnancy because it can cause abortion. Now let's go for the mucosal protective agents. We have the sucralfate and the bismuth salicylate. Let's begin with the sucralfate. Sucralfate is mainly a salt of sucrose complex to sulfated aluminum hydroxide. Okay, so it will form a gel, complex gel, will bind to the proteins found in the base of the ulcer to form a meshwork as a protective layer. It stimulates angiogenesis, that's why it will increase the repair rate. Okay, so what are the uses? Gastritis, stress ulcer, decrease the risk of upper GI bleeding. The side effects the most commonly is the constipation, and you should also avoid the long-term use because it increases the risk of pneumonia infection. Okay, so now for the bismuth salicylate, it acts in a similar way to the sucralfate. It also inhibits the pepsin activity, not the secretion. It increases the prostaglandin production, which in turn will increase the angiogenesis, which will increase also the cell turnover. Another thing which is important is the it has the direct antimicrobial activity against the H. pylori infection. That's why it is used in the quadruple therapy, which will be mentioned later on. For the side effects, the most important side effect is the darkening of the stool and the tongue. As you can see in here, this is the sign of hairy tongue. Okay, hairy tongue, which is seen with the bismuth salicylate. It is also contraindicated for patients who have any active bleeding. So this is just a summary of what we have said, the antacid, the muscarinic, anti-muscarinic, and the hyposecretory drugs. We are left only with the antimicrobial agents. Also a summary of the mechanism of action of the PPIs, the misoprostol, the H2 receptor blocker, and the antimuscarinic drugs. This also can show you the clinical use of the H2 blockers, the PPIs, and the antacid and bismuth salicylate. Now let's go for the antimicrobial agents, which are used mainly for eradication of the H. pylori infection. So you have to eradicate it because it can cause peptic ulcer disease. The American College of Gastroenterology guidelines and recommendation for 2007 and for 2014 from up to date will include the following management. So we have the first line therapy, the second line therapy in here, and then we have the third line therapy, or as we can say, the triple therapy, quadruple therapy, and the rescue therapy. Okay, so let's see the triple therapy or the first line therapy. If the patient doesn't have any penicillin allergy and not resistant to macrolide, usually use PPI once daily or twice. For any other than esomeprazole, you use clarithromycin 500 mg twice daily, amoxicillin 1000 mg twice daily. And if the patient is allergic to penicillin, you usually substitute the amoxicillin with the metronidazole. 500 milligram also twice daily. Now, if the patient faced failure of eradication, we go usually for the quadruple therapy, and this also could be used for a penicillin allergic patient, and this is considered the second line. So you give a PPI, you give the bismuth succinate, okay, 4 times daily, 525. You give the metronidazole, and you give the tetracycline. Both of them are 4 times daily. Now, what is the third line therapy or the rescue therapy? You give them PPI, you give them levofloxacin, which is a fluoroquinolone, and then you give them amoxicillin. If the patient is allergic to penicillin or amoxicillin, you can give them metronidazole instead of the amoxicillin. General measures for the antimicrobial agents, you have to ensure the patient compliance on the dosing because it requires multiple doses during the day, and the duration of the treatment is usually 10 to 14 days. Now, what are the eradication rates for the first line therapy? It is 85% because of increasing resistance of the clarithromycin, and the second line therapy, it is usually 95% and 95% of eradication. Now, the first line therapy or the triple therapy can be used in pregnancy because it has low risk, especially after the 14 weeks of gestation, or just delay the treatment after the delivery if the patient doesn't have any symptoms. And these are our references.